This Steve Jones Show podcast is now loading. The Steve Jones Show podcast is presented by Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers. Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more, this is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
This half hour of the show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, the best in new inventory with great warranties, great pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors Guarantee, terrific service department that backs it up from routine to difficult at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. The profession of sports journalism will get a bit poorer when the month is over with, because Dave Jones will not be a part of it, at least in terms of the active member of the fraternity. He has done great work for decades, and we're privileged to have him with us today. Dave, my friend, it's great to have you with us.
That is not entirely true, because it looks like I'm going to become Chris Berman, like you can't get rid of me, like I'm supposed to retire, and then I just keep hanging around because the Social Security Administration has not gotten back to me, and it's been like a month. So if I don't get my money, I'm not quitting. It could be July before they get back to me, from what I've heard. I don't know. So it might be another month or so. But anyway, can I do my impersonation of you while I'm on?
Yep. Hey, look, let's have some fun here. That's the whole purpose of it.
Go ahead. Pick it in the middle. Out to Lundy. The kick to Lundy. To Funk on the rim. This for the lead. Go on.
You're better me than me.
Go on.
It's good. All right.
No, it's good.
God.
You can't even do you.
No, I can't. I'm struggling.
When you were a little kid, did you ever listen to like WLS or some of those stations on AM radio? You remember the guy in Chicago doing LaSalle?
Yeah, the 50,000 watt stations. You could pick all that stuff on.
And he'd say it, and they had a promotion with some bread company, and he'd say, "It's good, just like a loaf of vanilla bread."
Oh, goodness.
You never had to do that.
No, I have not. Nobody's even asked either, and I probably would say no, but that's all right.
No, you wouldn't. You all have to say yes.
Dave, what has it been like being as passionate about basketball as you are, and I am? What's it been like? Did you think that the basketball appetite in this state would change after decades, or are you surprised it's still where it is in this state?
Yes, I did, because I came from some place where there is one. I came from the Midwest, and I thought the sport had simply been neglected, and it's a football school, and I thought, well, if they get a product that's exciting and fun, they'll come around. But
yeah,
we've seen, it's not like Penn State has had a lot of that, but we've seen little pockets of that sort of, I mean, last year, holy crap, last season was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
That team was fun. How many times did they take the blanket, the curtain off the upper deck? Like once?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm surprised, but now I've come to grips with the fact that the area is just immersed in contact sports. That's who it is, and it'll never be the Midwest. It won't, but that's what we have to deal with, right?
Yeah, no, I understand that. Is it going to be difficult once the time comes and the Social Security Administration sees it your way? Is it going to be difficult for you to step away from the world of opinion and hot takes, or is there a part of this that's going to be
sick of hearing my own voice as many others are. I'm sick of reading my own words. Everyone's going to be surprised how easily, especially my wife, Anna, who you've met.
Yes, Anna's great.
As easily as I'm going to assimilate into the world beyond this. Because, you know, really, we need a younger person needs to do it. You need to have a younger person with the passion, especially for Penn State football. I just don't have it anymore. Basketball was always my favorite sport. I think that probably shone through to some extent. And I love telling stories, but as far as the day-to-day grind of covering a football season, I'm not interested anymore. I'm not. I'm just not. And that, for sure, I'm not going to do again, even if my overdue retirement bleeds another couple of months into the future. I'm not going to be Chris Berman. I'm not coming back. And that's fine. I'm going to get used to it very easily, yes.
What do you want to do? I mean, it could be nothing. It could be something. What would you like to do?
I wouldn't mind having a little job for bourbon money with some basketball program maybe around here. Mm-hmm. Or I think I'm probably going to be able to work on a contract basis for an operation around here called City of Basketball Love. Josh Verlin has done a wonderful job, and he actually sold it to the Enquirer, so I'm hoping to be able to write a few just game stories on local Big Five games, that kind of thing, for walking around money, and just to be involved in college basketball. And, you know, if Mike Rhodes decides he's got a job for me up there, I'd do that. Yeah. If Pat Flannery gives me a gopher job where I gotta go pick up recruits, go get this, someone to order around, do this, sweep that up, get this, get him, go pick him up, I'd do that. Yeah,
Steve Jones.
A basketball program, that would be fun.
Tell Steve Jones that Dick Girardi, the plane leaves in 15 minutes.
Yeah, tell Girardi to move it.
We're leaving without him. Let's go, DJ. For you, when you're cutting your teeth on all this, who really influenced you, Dave? I mean, you end up being your own man, but there's certain things along the way we all take from somebody else. Where did that come from for you?
The earliest guy was a guy named Dick Fenlon, who you probably never even heard of. He started out as a columnist in Louisville way back, covered Adolph Rupp and Joe B. Hall and those programs, and then came to Columbus when I was just starting at the Columbus Dispatch in the early 80s. Dick Oddy, the managing editor, who was the sports editor there, brought him in, and Dick became the managing editor. And Dick Fenlon was just a terrific columnist. He told stories and didn't take himself too seriously, put a little humor in it. He was the first guy I thought, man, that guy's cool, and he's got it. He's got the idea that we should take our job seriously, but not ourselves. And Dick Fenlon was a terrific columnist. And then after that, I had contemporaries that I wanted to be Chris Dufresne at the LA Times. He was the epitome of a guy who, you know, he could do things I could not do. He was more spare in his prose. Understated, but told a story without falling over himself. Didn't want to be he was less of a columnist and more of just a great reporter. He told a great story. I don't know if you've ever read this, but in the 1997 tournament, the Chauncey Billups Colorado team beat Indiana, beat them bad, like 80 to 62, I think the score was.
Ran them out.
Yeah, in Winston-Salem. And it was near the end of Knight's tenure there, and he was getting pissed off, and it was like the third to last year. And then he was run out in 2000, so that was the third to last season. And Chris was out on, this is a legendary column among reporters, and Chris happened to be, you know how you are sometimes after the game, the media workroom will be right next to the loading dock. In those situations, underneath the arena, and the buses leave out of the loading dock for the teams.
Yep.
And Chris was like hanging around there for some reason and was just watching, looking at stuff. Walked out and started talking to some of the guys on the loading dock, who were actually workers at the arena in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, and said, did the Indiana team bus leave? And they said, yeah. And they said, somebody said that Knight wasn't on the bus. And Chris went, what? He said, yeah. He walked straight out the loading dock out of the main thoroughfare out there. And Chris got in his car. It's raining, by the way. It's just a miserable, rainy, cold night in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Chris, just on a lark, thinks, well, maybe he's walking back to the team hotel. And these guys swore he didn't get on the bus, so what else could he do? It's like 3 miles away. He gets in his car and goes down the main drag of Winston-Salem through some not great areas, by the way.
Yep.
And there's Bob Knight walking down the sidewalk next to this, like, four-lane main drag with his houndstooth hat pulled over his face, trudging back to the hotel. And Chris, like, doubled back just to make sure he'd seen what he thought he saw. But he didn't stop his car and, like, walk up and say, oh, hey, coach, what are you doing out here? He just told the story. And it's a great story. It's a great story. And it's just a moment in that guy's career. And that's the kind of guy I wanted to be that I never could be. Chris Dufresne was a terrific writer. He died of an aneurysm, tragically, like a couple of years ago. And wonderful, wonderful guy.
Joe always had those get-togethers on Friday nights in Bud Tallman's room and so forth. And at Michigan State, when we all knew Ronnie Chris was going to retire, everybody got up and had to say something. And you, of course, being at the Patriot News with him, gave a very emotional speech. What was it about Ronnie that made that emotion come out, and what did you learn from him?
You forget. The real one was at Virginia. Because that was 2001, and the game had been postponed because of 9/11.
Got moved back. Yeah.
Yeah. That's that was
right.
November. It was. Yep. It was. It was November 30th.
It was December 1.
2001, and the game was on December 1st. Yeah.
Yep.
And that's where it was. And.
Yeah.
The funny part is, I remember I kind of got choked up, and I had to like leave.
Yes, well, I remember.
I didn't get all the way through the speech.
Yep.
And because Ronnie was the mentor at the Patriot News, and a guy I'd been sitting next to for a long time. And I don't know, I get emotional those things. I'm kind of like Roy Williams or, you know, Dick Bennett, where I get emotional in those situations.
But that's fine. That's called
being.
Yeah,
but the funny part was everyone sitting there, and Joe, I heard later, Joe went, what the hell just happened?
That's exactly right. I think I was the one sitting next to Joe. Joe's like, what the hell happened there? I looked over, I said, Dave got overcome, he left. He goes, really?
What the hell just happened, man? I thought he was going to say something, man. Let me call some people. I'll find out where he is.
No, but he looked over at me. That's what I said. Well, I said, he got overcome with emotion. He goes, really?
It's like, okay. As if that was inconceivable, right?
Yeah. Oh, but it's okay to be human, Dave. You know, it's like, what the heck? We all get emotional.
Yeah.
My goodness.
I'm very emotional. Yeah. That's why I always got along great with Bill O'Brien, because we would, at any moment, we could rage into profanity-laced tirades, you know.
Yeah. Bill, okay, because Joe didn't swear. Okay, like I probably heard him say five or six ever in 32 years. Well, of course, Bill was 180 of that. So
yeah.
one day they're in practice, and it's like being at a sailor's locker room before the boat sails, right? and all of a sudden, and I'm just standing there, and he looks over, he says, and if you don't like the swearing, you can leave. And I said, no, I said, I do basketball. He looked at me and goes, that's why I like you.
I still have his classic rant on my tape recorder.
Oh, that's great.
I don't know if you've ever heard it, but I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing.
Well, DJ,
the one where he's about to put his fist through the windshield, that one.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Yeah.
Oh, how much have you picked up from DJ over the years? Girardi loves basketball like no other.
Everything. He knows the game better than I do. He sees the intricacies. He sees the little things during a game that make you look forward to what might happen rather than saying the obvious crap that you already saw.
Right.
And I constantly are peppering him. I'm peppering him with his looking for his opinion about things. And I do that with a lot of people, partly to check myself in what might be an entrenched opinion that's not entirely accurate, but also for his expertise, because he's got a ton of it. He really understands the geometry of the game, coaching adjustments, and not just the cliche crap that people say, in-game adjustments, little stuff that coaches actually do to mitigate their weaknesses and accentuate their attributes of their team, because you got to do that. Almost everybody's team is imperfect, except maybe the teams at the very top, and they can just roll the ball out. But every other team, certainly Penn State teams, have had to make those little adjustments. And when coaches can do that, and think of what Micah Shrewsbury did last season with just an amalgam of different guys from all over the place. He figured out a way for Jalen Pickett to run the team in a way that nobody had done here. It was very creative. It wasn't entirely new, but he certainly used Jalen Pickett's assets to the maximum degree. And that's what allowed them to accentuate their shooters and everything.
That's right.
I don't think anyone imagined that, but Micah Shrewsbury. Dick sees other things, all sorts of things, so he's constantly somebody I talk to and call and bug and badger and then argue with. See, he doesn't understand, and I guess it's completely understandable that he doesn't understand why I consult him and then I start arguing with him. Like, if you don't want to know what I'm talking about, then don't call me, you know? But I can't help it. I argue with everybody.
But you know what? But people ask me about the broadcast part, and it's the same thing with Jack. And I've always made sure, consciously, that they have as much room as possible to talk and not the other way around, because I think that those are the difference makers in the broadcast. Like, Dick's a difference maker. Fans learn more about the game when the game is over because of him. And that's why people say, well, sometimes there's 15 in the shot clock and you'll start talking. That's because what he's saying is important. I mean, it's just two guys watching basketball, two guys watching football. That's how we've always approached it.
Plus, he's easy on the ears.
Oh,
his
God,
delivery
yes.
is that yes. offhand, kind of casual.
Yep.
By the way, I just noticed this. Instead of the urgent, you know, Joe Tessitore, everything is meaningful. Kind of, you know, those guys just get exhausting.
It's a 2-yard gain.
And Tessitore's, he's not the right example because he's not an analyst. How about Jesse Palmer? You know, guys like that never freaking shut up.
I know. And don't say anything. And don't say anything.
Right. Yeah. And just gargle crap. You know, nonstop gibberish. And you just want them to shut up. That's never true of Dick.
Hey, Calipari's going to take the Arkansas job. I don't think it's totally surprising he's leaving Kentucky.
Yeah. What do you know?
It's not totally surprising there, and I think people don't realize how much money is in Arkansas between Tyson Foods and Walmart, the Walton family, and so forth. But what do you think of today's climate, both in coaching salaries, NIL, and player movement?
Well, there has to be a point like the Supreme Court, none other than Brett Kavanaugh, has already said that college players are employees. So that bridge has been crossed. It's a unanimous opinion. And so we need to progress quickly onto, and certain people who love college athletics abhor this idea, but we need to progress now. The more quickly we progress to a collective bargaining unit with the players, yes, a union, then we can set limits on NIL, yep. Legally set limits on NIL, the length of the portal, how often somebody can transfer. As long as those things are negotiated, there is no legal argument against them because a collective bargaining unit has agreed to them. Then everything's legal. That's the only way this Wild West is going to stop. And nobody likes it. Coaches hate it. But as far as the coaches bitching about it and complaining about the lack of loyalty, you know, screw those people. Really, really. You're talking about coaches being disloyal? Are you kidding me? So,
yeah.
I know it's frustrating for fans. It's frustrating, and it's hurting the sport. It's hurting the continuity of men's basketball especially.
Yeah.
And I think as the women's game grows, it'll hurt it too. I mean, yep. Dawn Staley just put together a team full of five new faces, five new starters.
Yeah.
But would the game be better if there was more continuity, if there were players who stuck around 3 and 4 years, which they could do? They could get paid and stick around longer. The answer is just NIL on the portal. There has to be a cap on these things, and there could be.
Yeah.
There can be if we move on it.
When I referred to Dave as my good friend, I mean it. Dave, thanks so much. Appreciate it. I had an absolute blast talking to you today, like I always do. Thanks so much.
Steve, it was good!
Dave Jones.
There's something to be said about a sale with a handshake. A service technician who really knows what he's doing. They can explain it in English what the problem is. There's nothing better than having that friend you could trust in the area. That's Sunbury Motors, where you get selection, knowledgeable salespeople, and prices that fit your budget, and more important, that friend you can trust. Welcome to Sunbury Motors, Kia, Ford, and Hyundai. You could shop other dealers and compare prices, but at Sunbury Motors, you get their lowest price promise. They research the current used vehicle market and guarantee their used car prices are the lowest. If you find a lower price, Sunbury Motors will beat it. Three dealers all in one. See their full new and pre-owned inventory at sunburymotors.com. Pick out a vehicle you like and schedule your test drive online. Follow them on Facebook. Sunbury Motors Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
You want a unique way to display your brand. You need a team of seasoned experts to work with. You want to reach customers who buy. You want NIL Game Changers, a versatile consulting agency powered by former student athletes and coaches who work as NIL sports agents. NIL Game Changers will help you build powerful relationships with customers through compelling stories, with student athlete influencers at your leading edge. Finally, we'll equip you with the right media to drive your success home. NILGameChangers.org, building meaningful relationships with your customers.
Spring has sprung, and it's time to dust off those insurance policies. For over 100 years, the Purdy Insurance Agency has been protecting families and businesses of the greater Susquehanna Valley and beyond. With the experience of our trained and knowledgeable staff, you can rest assured that your needs will be evaluated and met by some of the industry's best representatives. No matter what your insurance needs are, call Purdy Insurance today at 570-286-5855 or visit our website at purdyinsurance.com to see what we can do for you.
Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by NIL Game Changers, Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, and Brewers Outlet. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
And this half hour brought to you by NIL Game Changers. The ultimate destination for name, image, and likeness, whether it's your organization, your business, individually, athletically. It is NIL Game Changers. Go to NILGameChangers.org. Hope you enjoy that opening conversation. Couple quick things, and then we got Scott Fransky at 2:05.
That is correct.
It's starting to get dark in some areas. The suit's taking a nap. So yesterday, as you know, Iowa was beaten by South Carolina, and it reminded me so much of 1979 when Indiana State and Larry Bird played Michigan State. And the reason is that the better team beat the better player. Michigan State had Magic. They had Greg Kelcer. They brought Jay Vincent off the bench. And the better team, Michigan State, beat the better player. And the better player in the championship game didn't have his best night, or in this case, her best afternoon. Larry Bird in the championship game had a double-double. Hey, that always sounds great. But again, as you know here, we don't go into the, you know, right, this isn't the kindergarten sports class, okay?
He had a double-double. Like, oh, wow, he must have had a great game. Golly gee willikers.
No, we kind of take you a little further than that as to what really is a good game and what isn't. Bird had 19 points and 13 boards that night. Really, you know, it's on the surface sounds great, except he took 21 shots to get the 19 points. He was like 7 to 21 from the field. He just all night long kept waiting for him to go. And this is, by the way, and this is pre- three-point shot, so all his attempts were twos. And he had 19 points and 13 boards. He just didn't play well. Michigan State did a great job at defending him. He just could never get going, and Michigan State won the game by double digits. Well, yesterday, Caitlin Clark scored, 18 in the first quarter? And after that, she was an absolute non-factor. You know, you're going to see this. She scored 30 points in her finale. She took 28 shots to get the 30 points. That is not a good day. Just like I pointed out, Larry Bird took 21 shots to get 19 in the championship game. Right? Again, the best player, Bird, lost to the better team. The best player, Clark, lost to the better team. She had a phenomenal career. And more is in front of her. Now, the WNBA is a little different because the way the schedule's set up, every time there's a draft, NHL, NBA, NFL, there's always time between the draft and when they go to camp. Or in the NBA's case, sometimes some summer league games, but still time before you go to camp. There's a big gap between the draft. They'll go OTAs and things like that before you actually get to training camp. The WNBA isn't like that. They'll have the draft, and it isn't going to be long before they're in camp and they're playing games. So that's what makes it tough on rookies in that league. And that's something that needs to be pointed out ahead of time so people understand what she is getting into, what Angel Reese is getting into, what Cameron Brink is getting into. Because you could tell yesterday in the fourth quarter, she's exhausted. You could see it. Right, not winning, shots really short, missing layups, turning it over. Right, she's tired. She's had a lot on her plate, and she has beautifully represented Iowa, beautifully represented the sport, and in a sport that has, you know, from Cheryl Miller. And then working their way through the various outstanding players, the Rebecca Lobos, Jen Rosati, Shamika Holzclaw, Cheryl Swoops. You know, you get the Diana Taurasi, Sue Bird, Maya Moore, you know, Brianna Stewart. I mean, you got a lot of terrific players, right? They all inched the sport ahead. She moved it ahead by yards, to her credit. Because the game, of course, has changed.
I mean, it was the game of Wilt and Russell in the 60s. And then the advent of Bird and Magic came in, and suddenly passing and teamwork allowed that to just take the NBA. And they're the ones that really got the NBA going because they brought team basketball back into it. And then the dunking part really came into play. And then Steph Curry showed up. And, you know, people, after being enamored with the dunk, then really became enamored with the deep three. Not just any three, the deep three. And she plays the game a lot like Steph Curry. The deep three. I mean, as somebody who has stood on the spot where she hit the shot to go past Pete Maravich, it was 33 feet away. 33 feet. I talked to Bobby Hansen, who played with Jordan, and I said, geez, Bobby, I said, that's at least 30 to 35 feet. And he said, Steve, it's 33. Because they'd measured it out just to see. Yeah. I mean, and people loved it. They loved how she played the game, the flair with which she's played with, and so forth. But yesterday, it was the better player losing to the better team. We saw that with Larry Bird and Indiana State in 1979. On a day where the better player had to be over-the-top awesome to win, he was not that night, and she needed to be over-the-top and awesome for them to win, which she was in the first quarter, and then became very ordinary the last three quarters, and Iowa needed the first quarter Caitlin Clark to win because the better team beat the better player. And, you know, does that take away anything? No. But see, that's what strikes me about, and as always, for some odd reason, has struck me about the women's game, is that, yeah, you'll get some of these little petty, especially in the Twitter era, petty fights between teams or players or fans or whatever. But the women's game's always been interesting. It's like, instead of embracing the greatness that's out there, they'll get on each other's case about things. And I don't understand that. Right? We all know how much everybody loves Kelly Mazzani, right? I mean, Kelly is one of the absolutely terrific players and people you'll ever want to meet. And as you know, last week when Paige Beckers, when Gina was saying, I would not trade her for anybody, everybody's like, how can you say that? It's like, it's his player. I can understand that. He didn't put down the other player at all. He just praised his player. Well, that's what you're supposed to do. I mean, I would hope that the suit would praise the show. He praises Todd. There's an issue there.
Maybe that's why I'm a suck-up.
Maybe that's why you got the praise.
That's true.
But no, you always want to have the back of the people you're with. That's an important thing. Jack Hamm and I talk about this all the time. How important, no matter what, is we always... Okay, Jack and I have always, and Dick and I, have always had each other's backs. Always. Like not even a moment of hesitation, always had each other's backs. And that's what you do with an organization. But I remember when Kelly didn't get Player of the Year in the Big Ten. Now, do I think she should have been Player of the Year? Sure, I did. But it went to Lindsey Whalen. And I remember, like, the press conference in, you know, and look, and Marini was great, okay? And was great to me and everything like that. So it doesn't mean I have to agree with everything. But I was like, you know, but, like, she was like, it was one of those uncomfortable press conferences, like, okay, like, your player's great, which Kelly is, was. Right? But there's no need to. My thought was at the time, there's no need to do that. Right? Well, now you're seeing it with Caitlin Clark. I mean, Breanna Stewart. I mean, you got to win a championship to really be great. You got to, you know, a Diana Taurasi, you know, said a couple of things. Right? But there was, like, as time went, as the season was going, there were just a couple of snippy things said from within them. And all she's doing is bringing eyeballs to something they've been desperately trying to get eyeballs to see. They should have been, and that's why Dawn Staley thanked her after the game. That was classy. That was classy. The question's going to be moving forward. What's going to happen? And here's going to be, I'll give you an issue that they're going to have in moving forward. Who will, now we all know Paige Beckers will be one of the faces of the game next year, but who will be another face of the game? Juju Watkins. What's the problem with Juju Watkins? Todd, what would you think the problem would be having Juju Watkins being one of the faces of the game be?
She's on the West Coast.
Yeah, exactly. She's at USC. Now, she will be playing in the Big Ten. Now, we don't know whether she's coming here next year or not. They don't have that schedule out yet. But she plays on the West Coast. So let me ask everybody out there. Let's take away highlights on ESPN. Take away the highlights. How many of you ever saw Ichiro actually play a game when he was with the Mariners? Like, actually play a game? Or did you just see all his hits on highlights? When have you actually seen Mike Trout play four or five games in a season? How about Shohei Ohtani? How many times have you actually seen Shohei Ohtani? Not on highlights on ESPN. How many times have you seen Shohei Ohtani actually play? I mean, how often? I mean, unless it's the playoffs, how often do you see LeBron play now? I mean, that's the problem. The games are starting at 10:30 at night. Now, I did take some time this year to watch some of the USC men, UCLA, Oregon, Washington. So I'd see a little bit of the late night games, like 5-10 minutes here and there, just to start getting a read on what they do. But 47% of the population in this country is in the Eastern time zone. And it's hard to make her one of the faces of the game when she is going to have 2/3 of her games on the West Coast. Not going to be easy. You know? I mean, that's something that like, it's one of those, of all the luck of the draw things, that happens to be where she's playing. And, yeah, I mean, USC's a fine program. You know, Galen Center's really great, the whole deal. Getting into the Big Ten's going to be great. Across the board, that'll help somewhat. BTM will certainly publicize it, but it's going to be hard to watch her, especially either at UCLA, Oregon, Washington, or playing home games, to actually watch her play.
It's kind of on the powers that be to kind of get her on during the afternoon on the weekends then, probably, isn't it?
Yeah, you'd think so, but then here's the difficulty. You're at BTN, Fox, and so forth, okay? And they'll work it out to get some games on for her, no doubt, because I'm sure they feel that that's going to be a draw. But in reality, you know, outside of Caitlin Clark, you're getting your numbers from the men's game. So what, are they going to look at BTN and say, hey, we're not going to do this game? We're going to do this one instead? Or Fox, we're going to do this game instead of that? No. Because, first of all, every Big Ten men's game, especially in conference, has to be on TV. Whether it's Fox Sports 1, BTN, Fox, okay, any conference game has to be on. You notice that in men's basketball, no conference game is on ESPN+. Maybe on Peacock, and Peacock got a good draw this year. But not on ESPN+. I meant to say BTN+. Because it's the way it is. Is it raining there?
I don't think so, though I haven't looked out the window since 1 o'clock.
Well, we've had a little rain here, but it's clearing up a little bit, and we're getting close to the eclipse time here. 3:20 will be totality here. I think 3:20, 3:21, something like that. And I've got people I know that went up to Rochester, and it's 95% cloud cover. I know somebody's going up to Burlington, Vermont. Right? Suit's already napping.
He's throwing his circadian rhythms off.
No, that sleep machine, no way. That sleeping machine, I mean, you could tell on Friday nights that there are moments he's asleep. All right, so, need the rest. Tonight should be interesting. John Calipari, massive deal at Arkansas, but they've got the money. They've got the money. Between Tyson Foods and Walmart, they got the money. Okay? And now the question is going to be, what do they do? What do they do? Is it Nate Oates?
That seems to be the current rumor.
Yeah. Ah. Interesting, interesting. Funny, I was just talking about it because I spoke in Jacksonville and Daytona over the weekend. And for some, somebody brought it, not about him, but about like guaranteeing contracts for coaches. And they said, well, the key is the buyout. And it was his buyout that I brought up. Well, if you got the money, you got the money. Like Texas A&M, I think it was the Booster Club. I believe they're the ones that paid the buyout, the $77 million. The athletic department didn't have to do it. Wow. That's some donor base.
Well, I'm guessing John's not paying his buyout either at Kentucky. I think the Tyson guy will take care of that for him.
And by the way, he and the head of Tyson Foods, they are tight, by the way. He and Calipari are tight. So that helps. All right. We'll take a break. Back with more in a moment. This half hour brought to you by NIL Game Changers. Go to NILGameChangers.org on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection. Imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patronage.
Is it the eighth inning? No? Fenway Park.
And it is drizzling a little bit here.
Okay. Ah, I finally get one of these moments. Where you've got a total eclipse coming up. At least here it's 96%. And this is the deal?
It was beautiful yesterday, and it's supposed to be beautiful tomorrow.
I know. It's going to be 72 tomorrow, too.
I know. I'm excited. I have a softball game. I'm going to sun myself like a big snake.
Yeah, I may go out and play golf after the show tomorrow, then go over to practice. But, all these people have been, like, counting on this, and it's like the last thing you wanted was this.
Especially if you traveled.
That's a bummer. Yeah, and people have traveled. There's some place like Bloomington, Indiana. It's nice and sunny there today, which is good. All right. Scott Fransky, next half hour. This half hour has been brought to you by NIL Game Changers. Go to NILGameChangers.org.